What about this?
Yeah.
There you go. We thank you for coming out today for this memorial service for our pastor, our friend, Danny Eiler. And to just give you a little bit of an idea of where we're going today, this may be a little bit different than most memorial services that you've been a part of. And one of the reasons we believe that's going to be important for us is because we believe this is Danny. The more you knew Danny Eiler, the more you'll understand why we're doing what we're doing today. Danny had a passion. He had a passion to serve God. He had a passion to lead this church. He had a passion to reach out and minister to the community. He had a passion to worship. And not only did he have a passion to worship, but he also had a passion to see other people worship. There have been many times that I saw Danny as we were worshiping on Sunday morning in the Springs. I would see Danny as he was just looking over and watching people worship and enjoying their worship. This is who Danny Eiler was. And as we worship together today, we are worshiping, celebrating the life of Danny and doing what we believe Danny would want us to do. Worship together today. He has experienced now the greatest time of celebration and worship that he had ever experienced. While we had a lot of great times of worshiping together as a church family at the Springs and many other times that he's been involved in worship, none of the earthly worship compares to what Danny's experienced the last week. And we know that what we do today won't compare to that either. But we ask you today to join us in worship, and let's do our part today to remember Danny, but to do so through this time of worship together. Will you join us? Will you stand with us this afternoon as we worship together?
Die.
be seated.
The Eiler family came to be a part of the church family at the South Seminole Baptist Church more than 20 years ago. And it was at that time that I first began to know Danny as a part of our children's ministry. I will never forget when he came and told me that he was beginning to sense that the Lord had a real purpose for him and had called him to ministry. And then I remember when he came forward in our church to share with our congregation that he was feeling the call of God on his life for full-time ministry. After that, we began to meet, and for months, and I don't remember how many now, we would meet weekly, and we would talk about the ministry. And what it meant to be a part of those who were called of God to lead congregations and to lead people in ministry and in growth in their faith. And we would examine passages of scripture. We would take questions that he had. We would talk about doctrinal matters and support them with scripture. And I began to really be impressed with Danny because I would give him assignments, and it was unusual for a young man his age to come back absolutely prepared, having investigated and examined and researched and studied. When he came back, he was prepared for that particular session that we would have together. I think it was interesting to watch him then through the years, for he never looked back. He did not second question his calling. In fact, he reminds me of a passage of scripture in Romans chapter 11 when the Apostle Paul said this, "For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable." That word irrevocable comes from the Greek word which has to do with not turning back, never turning back in the other direction. I never saw any hint that Danny in any way ever was even tempted to doubt his calling or to turn and go in another direction and examine another way of life. You will not find many young men his age who were the witness that Danny Eiler was. You will not find very many men that age, even as a teenager, who was without question filled with boldness when it came to the gospel. And quite honestly, even if he felt that there would be some ridicule or some people who would not maybe accept his ministry without some type of hesitancy, that did not slow him down. In Danny's life, the calling of God was irrevocable. As I thought about Danny's commitment and the ministry that God has given him through the years, I thought of two words: trusted and trusted. For the same Apostle Paul, who reminds us that the calling of God is irrevocable, once God's called, he doesn't lift the call, also said this to young Timothy: guard through the Holy Spirit who dwells in us the treasure which has been entrusted to you. Now that word guard means to put a garrison of soldiers, right? When God calls you, and entrusts eternal life, the power of the Holy Spirit, as we've been singing about. And when God entrusts you with a calling, he says, guard it. Show that God's trust in you has been validated. And I have no doubt today, but what in many who are gathered in this particular assembly, that you can affirm that when God entrusted to Danny Eiler the ministry, Danny guarded it. And he was trustworthy with the calling of God upon his life. For there are those in this assembly today who have a relationship with Jesus Christ because of the testimony and the witness and the preaching and teaching of the word that was part of Danny's ministry. Amen? And therefore, I can say that Danny has been trusted by the Lord with a calling, with a ministry, with a testimony. But oh, I also leave you with this thought, that also he was trusting when it came to the Lord. For listen to this. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord or of me, his prisoner. I never found him in any way ashamed of the gospel, in any way hesitant to share the gospel. He said, but join with me in suffering for the gospel according to the power of God who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was granted us in Christ Jesus from all eternity. There's no doubt but what Danny Eiler was called by God for a purpose. And bless your heart. Bless your hearts. That purpose has been fulfilled in many of your lives. The Apostle Paul goes on to say, but he now has been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. That means never dying. For which I was appointed a preacher. The gospel for which I was appointed preacher, apostle and teacher. And for these reasons I suffer these things, but I am not ashamed. And here it is. For I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day. I would not be a bit surprised that in these last years, as Danny has suffered physically and has had a pretty much of a roller coaster type experience, and he had to really entrust himself to the Lord. Just as God could trust Danny with the ministry and the testimony and the witness of his call, Danny, I'm positively unashamed of that, was also trusting the Lord concerning this very day. You see, Danny had a conviction. The ministry was not a vocation. It was a calling. It was a calling that once you've been called, you don't back off from and you don't turn from. And God trusted him with that calling, and God used him and has touched lives. And we will never know this side of heaven who all has been touched and will be touched by those whom he touched. But also, Danny knew that he was trusting the Lord Jesus Christ, who's not with you just in the high times when everything's going well and you're feeling really good, but who's there holding you up and strengthening you and guarding you in those times when you can't walk alone by yourself. So you see, Danny was both trusted of the Lord and also trusting the Lord. I don't know how a person can respond to the call of God on your life, nor how that person can actually be involved in that calling and carry out that calling without being trustworthy as far as God is concerned. God is trusting, but also being trusting and knowing that you are serving the only one who is not just good for this life, but for all eternity. And I have no doubt in my mind that right now, Danny is experiencing the wonderful, literal presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's still realizing more than ever before that as God gave him the privilege of being trusted by the Lord, he has been absolutely, wonderfully, and totally and completely trusting the Lord, and his trust has been affirmed. We celebrate the life and the testimony and the ministry and the witness and the absolute adherence to the calling of Daniel Eiler. But we also are here today to give glory and honor and praise to the Lord Jesus Christ, who both called, trusted, and now has been trustworthy for them. May we pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much. Lord, I thank you that through the power of your Spirit, you call those who you especially select to absolutely share your word, your testimony, your ministry, no matter what the cost. And I thank you for Danny. I thank you for the assurance that he had from the very beginning of his call. I thank you for his faithfulness. And Lord, I thank you for his family, his mom and dad, who saw to it that he had that foundation that was so important to him. Lord, this is a couple that's been faithful to you. Lord, I watched this dad when his health was really, really giving him weakness. I watched him come, listen to little boys and girls in one as they recited memory verses. I watched this couple be faithful through many types of illness. So, Lord, we know that Danny had a firm foundation in his heart. Then, Lord, we know that you trusted him to call him to your ministry. Lord, right now we know that he's been trusting you for this day and this time. I ask you to be with his dear wife, these dear little children, all of the family. I pray that they will be surrounded by a strong sense of your presence. And oh Lord, I pray that they will also have a sense of the love of your people. Lord, there are many different members of congregations who are gathered here to honor the memory of Danny, but also to celebrate you and give you glory and praise that a day like this is not a day of hopelessness, but instead it is a day of victory and celebration. We celebrate the life of man, and we celebrate and honor the Lord Jesus, who is the author of all life. And it's in his name I pray. Amen.
Had taken a temporary assignment as interim teaching pastor at the Springs, leading the Springs through a difficult time. I pastored for some 25 years prior to coming to the Springs, and I endeavored to reach out to Danny, mentor Danny as I could, and I would spend time with him when he would call and ask, or occasionally I would call, and we'd go grab breakfast or lunch together, and he always had questions. And one thing I remember about those times with Danny is he was never without his laptop. And as he would ask questions and I would share thoughts, he was typing my thoughts, and it would lead to another question, and he would ask another question, and as I would share thoughts, he would be busily typing, making sure he didn't miss anything. He wanted to learn everything that he could about ministry, everything that he could about leadership, everything that he could about being obedient and serving our Father. It was not an easy time for the Springs we were going through. We were a hurting church. We were wounded and going through some difficult times. And I watched Danny over the last 4 years. While there were other challenging times that came along as well, I watched Danny grow and mature in his preaching and teaching and in his leadership and in his spiritual walk. And quite frankly, I watched Danny grow into a very good pastor. And while I tried to help Danny learn some of the things that I have learned over the last 25 years, quite frankly, I learned some things from Danny. A number of those things I learned from Danny during that period of time. I know over the course of this last week, many of us have went to Facebook and we've posted thoughts and memories and stories about Danny. I posted something Monday morning, and Cassie asked that I share a little bit of with you today from my thoughts that led to that post on Facebook on Monday morning. And I basically started out, "That's not fair. That's not fair." As a parent, I grew tired of hearing that from my children, and I grow weary of hearing it in the society that we live in. We hear people use that so frequently over such trivial things, but the only thing that was coming to my mind Monday morning was, man, this is just not fair. Danny had so much to offer to Cassie and boys, to the Springs family, to his friends, to this community. He had so much to offer. He was so young. He had so much more yet to give. But as I thought about where we are, and as I thought about Danny's battle over the last 3 years or so, if I remember correctly, Danny was in the hospital when he, on his birthday, when he found out he had leukemia. What a way to spend your birthday. I think that was his 26th birthday. What a way to spend your birthday in the hospital learning you have leukemia. For almost 3 years, he fought that battle. We all believed that he would win this earthly battle with cancer. We believed it. And the same commitment that Danny took into his ministry, he had that same kind of resolve in this fight against cancer. One of the things that I learned from Danny, Danny, I believe, was the first one that I heard say it this way. He said, it's not my story, it's God's story, and I'm just a character in God's story. Were you here in time to see the pictures? He was quite a character. No question about that. He was quite a character. But he truly saw that it was God's story, and he was a role player. He was a character in God's story. Life was not his story. And I remember as my wife and I learned that he had leukemia, and we were talking about
what the future held for him. I remember us having a conversation, and I told her, I know how he's going to embrace this. It's God's story, and he's a role player in God's story. And whatever God lays out for him, he'll embrace it eagerly and with great resolve. And he did. He did. And we believe, because of that resolve, we believe that he would win this earthly battle. But God chose to take him home. God chose to give him the ultimate healing. And ultimately the opportunity to win his reward and enjoy this eternal time of celebration with God in the heavenly home that's been prepared for each of us. We may never understand the reasons why, but we do know this. It's God's story. And Danny today is playing out his new role in God's story. And he's doing so with just as much zeal and fervor as ever before, probably more, because he's never had anything like this to celebrate. So we'll miss him deeply, and we will certainly are thankful for the years that we had him in our lives and for the testimony that he left behind. But I'm going to resist the urge to scream, "That's not fair," and just accept the fact that our God is a sovereign God who has written an incredible story of redemption and eternal victory. In John chapter 3, verse 16, it tells us, "God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." That's what God's story is all about. And Danny lived his life to be a role player in God's story, making sure that everybody he knew how much God loved them. Making sure that everybody he met understood that there was something far greater than just this life. This story of redemption and eternal victory that drove Danny to do what he did has now brought Danny to a place of eternal rejoicing. And it wasn't just God's story that Danny was a role player in, but we're all role players in that same story of eternal redemption, eternal victory. And one day, just as Danny, those of us who've accepted Jesus Christ as our Savior, those of us whose names are written in that book of life, will come to the time where our role in God's story changes. And we'll embrace our time of eternal celebration right there with Danny in that heavenly home prepared by God for you and for me. I'm thankful to have had 4 years, such a short period of time, but 4 years, to learn and to know and to sit in the ministry of a faithful pastor, a faithful man of God, Danny. And I know you're thankful for your memories and for your time with you as well. Father, we just thank you and praise you for the privilege to be just a role player in your story. God, may we be as faithful as Danny. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name for the eternal victory you bring. Amen.
Would you guys stand with us? As we continue to worship, just let the Holy Spirit come and move in our hearts today. And it's okay to let yourself go and to cry, because that's what we're going to do up here, because we started this morning at service, and just, we're coming before God and we're worshiping Him with all we've got. So we just invite you to do the same. Thank you.
great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives in peace for me. My name is graven on his hand. My name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me this depart. No tongue can bid me this depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me
Good evening, everybody. I think to give us a little bit of perspective on where we all are, I think it helps to look a little bit in Scripture at another scene that was kind of familiar, where we look at another faithful follower who knew he was approaching the end of his time, and I just want to see what he says and just reflect a little bit as it pertains here. This is 2 Timothy 4. It says, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come." This is Paul that writes this, and he knew. Paul knew that he was at the end of his days. And so if you've ever heard somebody's dying wish, if you've ever heard somebody say something knowing they were running out of time, those words are important. Those words are important. So what Paul says is, pay attention. Pay attention. So what does he say next? It says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. And I have kept the faith." So this is not so much a text that I would go to as a reminder of Danny's outstanding athletic ability. I just wanted to see how many of you really knew him. But Danny fought. And I don't mean in death as much as I mean in life. And we've heard stories of ministry and the way that he labored and worked in ministry. And we know that. But I think we do him a disservice, and we do his family a disservice, if we stand here and say Danny was a great pastor. Because he was. But bad men don't make good pastors. And Danny was a fighter. Danny was somebody who ran the race. And I worked alongside him in ministry for a while. And he, I don't know if he knew it or not, but he mentored me. And he taught me a lot of things. And I wasn't ever able to truly appreciate the impact that he had had on other people until he passed. Could you look to your left and your right now? Isn't this amazing? When he passes and people start putting up stories on Facebook, and they blew my mind. Like, I thought I really knew the guy, and I thought I went back with him a ways. But the stories that people posted, some people that knew him for a long time, other people who hadn't known him for very long would post things like, "I met Danny in the supermarket. I dropped my purse, he picked it up, and led my whole family to Christ." It just didn't make sense, you know. You're probably here right now. But those were the stories that people tell. And it was exciting to work with him in ministry, and I learned a great deal from him. But I'm more privileged to have known him as a person, and the way that he impacted my life and his family's life, and the way they took care of Cassie and their kids. And he would not want to be remembered as a pastor primarily, but as somebody who followed Jesus faithfully. And he did. He ran the race. And let's see what's for him. It says, "Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to those who have loved his appearing." And so we come in here grieving and sad and through tears and pain. And all of that's legitimate, because we've lost a close friend. We've lost someone we love. And as much as it's appropriate to come in here and reflect and to be sad and to own that, there's something to be said for celebrating. There's something to be said for a race well ran, a fight well fought, a life well lived. And so I think this is spectacular that everyone's here. And I just want to simply end with a gesture. Would you now, with me, celebrate a life well lived? Would you celebrate a race well ran and a fight well fought?
His life was a life that was lived short in many ways, but a life that was lived rich. I want to share on behalf of Danny's colleagues, other pastors across our district and across the world, those who got to know Danny, that many people called me this past week and just shared how much they love him and had prayed for his healing. And we all, like Jay had said, are saying God is not fair, but God is sovereign, and God has a purpose and a plan bigger than us. Debbie and I, my wife, we went through the same thing. We're similar. We lost our spouses. And I know how painful it can be. I know the difficult, the challenge, and some of you know what it's like to have lost a close friend or a spouse or a child. And those are days are trying, are very challenging. And Cassie, my heart, Debbie and I, we have prayed for you throughout this week. Late at night, we wake up praying for you because we love you and we thank God for your faithfulness to Danny. You have been the champion of encouragement. You have gone to encourage him and he has encouraged you. And I know we talked in the hospital a little bit about the fact that sometimes we have insurance and sometimes we don't. And I want you to know on behalf of all of Danny's colleagues, we have rallied and every funeral expense will be paid for in entire. The best part about Danny is his fearlessness to me. I had many talks with him personally where I sat down one-on-one and I asked Danny something like this: Danny, you understand what you're facing. It's a pretty big, difficult journey. How do you feel? And he said, man, I'm just fine. And pastors have learned over the years that when people say it's just fine, that the second question you ask is, now tell me the real story. How are you really feeling? And Danny would say, no, you don't get it. I really am just fine. And then I was dumbfounded. Because I put myself in his place and I think I would have been full of fear. I would be full of questions. Not Danny. You see, the walk that he had as he taught you as people of the church all through his life, what he taught, he lived in the most pressing hours of life. And that's what it's all about, isn't it? It's not about how high you preach or how powerful you preach. It's how you walk. It's how you walk through the real difficult days of life. And Danny did that. And he said these words. And I heard it over and over again. I am not afraid. He was either crazy or he had a faith beyond comprehension. He knew something that he had been preaching personally. He knew Jesus. And you see, when you know Christ, something takes place that changes the way you look at life and the way you look at death. He was also a church planner. You heard the story from Jay Neal about how Danny took over the Springs after the founding pastor left. Those were some difficult days. And Danny was just a kid. And I remember sitting, I can still remember where I was sitting. And I was talking with Danny. And I said, Danny, do you think you can do this? He said, oh, I think I can. He didn't have a clue what he was saying yes to. I mean, I'm so glad he was young. Aren't you glad that some of you preachers, you know, when you were given opportunities, you didn't have a clue about what you were saying yes to? Danny didn't, but he had this optimism. I think I can do this. And all through the ministry, ups and downs and all around through the pastoral ministry, Pastor Perry, the things you taught him came back. His trust in God came back. All the things that you poured into him, we saw it evident. We were blessed by what you taught him and by what his mother and father taught him. And some of you friends, what you taught him as he grew up, he embodied that. He lived for Christ. He was like one of my boys. Often I would say, Danny, you're just like one of my boys. And what I meant by that is I loved the tar out of that boy. And sometimes I wanted to shake him and say, Danny. But you did too, because you loved him and you knew me. He was just like one of my boys. I love that boy. I love that boy. And when you love somebody and they go through a journey of pain and difficulty, your heart breaks. I got to admit to you that over the last couple of months, I kept saying to God, now God, we've got this story written out. You and I have got this story written out. We've got it all pinned, and we know how it's going to work out. And he's going to come back to preach, and he's going to come back and give testimony to your graciousness and your miracles and your healing. But God had another plan. And Danny, I think inside, he knew that plan. He could understand it. He could see it. And he still looked in the face of death and was fearless. How does somebody do that? It has to be Jesus. There is no other explanation besides the fact that this young man that was only 30 years old, he knew something that many of other people did not know, and that is that what he read and what he trusted was true. After Danny's death, Cassie shared the story. She said that, because one of the things about Danny, if you knew him, he loved his family. He loved Cassie. He loved Katie. He loved his family. And he not only loved his family, but he loved his church family. You see the pictures up there. Everywhere he was, he was not ever off of pastoring. He was always engaged with people. He loved people. He just loved people, whoever they were. He loved me. He loved you. He loved people. And Kate sat down with his mama after she shared about Danny's homegoing. And she said to him, and he said, Mommy, what's going to happen? Who's going to pay the bills? And Cassie said, well, I'll pay the bills. And Mommy, who's going to go take me fishing? Well, I'll take you fishing. And who's going to cook? And Cassie said, I'll learn how to cook. And Cassie said, I could share that. And then he asked this question. Mommy, who's going to teach me to be a man? I don't know about you, but that hit home to me. Because you see, Danny was always a teacher. Everywhere he went, he wanted to teach. And he loved the Word of God. And he loved to teach. And whenever I stood here and I shared with this congregation, Danny was always playing bass. He was not just a preacher. He loved to worship. And that's why this morning, or this afternoon, some of the things you heard in worship, that was what Danny loved. So that's for Danny. But he loved the Word of God. And I asked Cassie, I said, what is his favorite book? And she said, he loved Romans 8. Pastor, did you teach him Romans 8? I bet you did. Romans 8. And he said, foundation for me because I'm in Jesus Christ. Because through Jesus Christ, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin again. Romans 8, 11. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who lives in you. Romans 18, 19. I consider that our present sufferings are not worthy compared with the glory that will be revealed in us. Romans 8, 28. This is Danny. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him and who have called according to His purpose. And then Romans 8, 35 through 39. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship, or persecution or famine, or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we have faced death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor the present, nor the future, nor any power, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. That's Danny speaking to us this afternoon. Because he believed the Word, and the Word has now become sight. This very afternoon, if you believe the Word of God, you believe that this very moment, Danny is celebrating in heaven. Amen? Amen. That's the faith Danny had, and that's the faith I will use. But Danny also says something else. Cassie said this to me. She said, one of the things that really irritated Danny was the fact that he would go to funerals and preachers would preach messages and end with nice little cliches and nobody found Jesus. Now, you know what's coming next. would you bow your knee? If you're here this afternoon and you're a friend of Danny's, if I could just share this with you this afternoon, Danny wants you to know the same Jesus that he is now celebrating in heaven with. How do you know that? Well, the Bible says that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says if that we are to confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You say, but I've been in church all my life. You can be in church and still not be saved. You say, I've read the Bible. Doesn't that make me a Christian? You can read the Bible and still not be saved. You say, well, I'm a good person. You can be a good person and still not saved. You say, I live down south. I've heard the gospel all my life. I've got to be saved. That does not make you saved. So I'm going to pray, and if you pray along with me, if you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, the greatest tribute that you could give to Danny is that this very afternoon, you said yes to Jesus and prepare to one day see Jesus face to face, but also to celebrate around the throne of God, along with Danny and many other millions of saints of God. Father, we bow our head and our heart today. And we thank you for the life of Danny, but most of all, we thank you for Jesus. Because Danny simply found Jesus one day and walked in the footsteps of Jesus. And he gathered some people to walk in the same footsteps with him. And I look around this place this afternoon, and so many people are here today probably because they joined Jesus and they joined Danny in following after Jesus. And so I pray today, if there's anyone here that would simply say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. I repent. I turn away from my sins and I turn to Jesus. And I claim Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And this very afternoon, Lord, I ask that you come into my heart and save me and forgive me and make me a child of God. From this moment on, I'm no longer my own. I have now been bought with the price. I am a child of God. And Lord, I pray that all across this place, that there will be people who make a fresh commitment. And maybe there are some Christians here that have, they've been walking with Christ, they've made that commitment, but they begin to wander away. What a great day this would be if even some believers who become a little weak in their fellowship of Christ would turn their eyes back toward Jesus. What a tribute of a life well lived. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. One thing before they sing. It was said of D.L. Moody a long time ago, an evangelist. They said, one day you're going to read it in the paper, in the obituaries, that I died. When you read my name, don't you dare believe a word. He said, because I'll be more alive at that moment than I ever have been on her planet Earth. Amen. And I say to you this afternoon that Danny is not dead. Amen. Dan has just been translated to his eternal home. And I look forward to seeing him one day. Amen.
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 Would you stand as we sing together this song of Revelation? And we proclaim, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty.
celebrated deity, his life and his homeland. And we did so, as we told you from the beginning, with the one thing that he was probably most passionate about, and that's worshiping together. And I don't know if there's anything that comes close to rivaling that. For Danny, it might have been eating together after worshiping together. That's probably, I don't know, I'm just saying. What do you think? Probably so. So we're going to eat together. And we have, my understanding is we have plenty of food. Is that right? We probably have plenty of food. We need about 15 minutes of preparation pulling that together. So we're gonna eat together. And we're also going during that time to share some memories of Danny's life. And you may have noticed there wasn't a guest book to sign in when you came in. There's paper. My understanding, there's paper as we're sharing together for you to sign in with a memory to leave of Danny for the family. So when we gather together in just a few moments to share a meal and share memories, please grab a piece of paper and sign in and leave your memory of Danny for the family as well. Again, thank you for being with us afternoon. Father, we're just so thankful. And we have a God who loves us so very much. And Lord, there is nothing we ever face in our lives that surprises you. You're a sovereign God that has orchestrated it all. We thank you so much. God, as Skylar shared this morning, true faith is believing God enough that when we don't understand why things happen the way they do, we just trust you in your sovereignty, knowing this is your story. God, I just pray that your arms of love will be wrapped around Cassie and the family and this church and this community. And God, that as we leave this time of celebration together, we will not leave one another's presence and ultimately your presence without knowing, Lord, that we have family and friends to lean upon to take us through this difficult time, but more importantly, a God that will never, ever leave us or forsake us. To God be the glory. Great things you have done, and we praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.